Okay, today is Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. My name is Edna Sussman. I'm a reference librarian here at the Half Hollow Hills Community Library. We're interviewing Annabelle Weiss, a World War II Marine Corps veteran, as part of our Veterans Testimonial Project and in collaboration with the Library of Congress's Veterans History Project. Thank you so much, Annabelle, for your service and for being willing to participate in our project today.
You're very welcome.
It's our honor, truly. Annabelle, where and when were you born?
I was born in Manhattan, in New York City.
And when was that?
It was December 22nd, 1923.
And who were your parents, their names and occupations?
Sadie and Marty Dorfman. Sadie, my sainted mom, was a housewife and mom, best mom in the world. Dad was in the insurance business, and at his retirement in his 70s, he was the vice president of an insurance company.
Wow, nice. And did you have any siblings?
I had a sister.
What was her name?
Pearl.
Mm-hmm. Was she in the military, too?
No.
No. Now, what were you doing before you entered the service?
I was working in a defense plant trying to help my country because I was too young to get into service. I tried. So I was working at Sperry's, mm-hmm. and I was looking at parts of a gun sight.
How old were you then? Still in high school?
I was about 18.
Oh, finished with high school?
Oh, yes, and had some college.
Oh, where did you go to college?
Hunter College in the Bronx.
Okay.
And I left college and wanted to help my country, tried to enlist. They would not take me at 18 in those years. They said you had to be 20 years old to get into the Women's Marines, which had formed only a year before.
What year was that?
That was 1943 or 1944. Okay. I got in 1945 mm-hmm. when I was 20.
Mm-hmm.
That was the age, with my parents' consent.
Oh, they had to sign?
I had them consent, yes, huh. A piece of paper.
Now, you enlisted in the Marines?
Absolutely.
Why did you pick the Marines?
They just attracted me. My whole family of cousins, boy cousins, were in every other branch of the service. We had everything. They enlisted. There was no draft in those days. Uh-huh. So everybody enlisted. So I said, what's left? The Marine Corps. Let me examine that. Oh, they look great. I'm going to do that.
Okay. So what happened when you departed for training? Did you go to basic training?
Yes, I went to Camp Lejeune for the boot camp by train, and I guess the bus made a visit at the train stop. They brought us to the Camp Lejeune mm-hmm. for boot training.
Mm-hmm.
And after our boot training...
How long was that?
I think it was very close to what the men had, maybe... One or two weeks less than what the men had as boot camp at mm-hmm. Paris Island, like my husband.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure. I think it must have been, I don't know, maybe 12 weeks, 10 weeks, something like that. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I've forgotten. And, of course, I didn't think I was going to make it. It was awfully hard. And
was it?
I was small.
Yeah.
But I had been relatively active in my young years. I rode horses and I swam and played a little bad golf, bowled mm-hmm. badly. but I was active, so I made it.
Were you in training with just other women or men at the same together?
All women.
So
our drill sergeants was a man.
Ah. What was he like? You remember?
Sergeant Needleton was a very nice man. Mm-hmm. He was very humanitarian. It was very hot where we were training in the summertime, mm-hmm. and the temperatures reached over 100 degrees while we were drilling. Some of the women fell, mm-hmm. fainted from the heat, and he was very nice about it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't.
You, thank goodness.
I took it, yes.
What did you learn, and did you learn specialized training?
Well, the first thing they taught me was about the airplane engine that I was supposed to be inspecting. Well, not in boot camp. Are you talking about boot camp?
Yeah.
Oh, no, at boot camp, what they taught us was marching, drilling, how our lockers and beds were supposed to be made, exactly. It's not a joke that you had to bounce a quarter off of your sheet.
Really? Yeah.
It's true. And prepare for inspections when people came to see us from Quantico or other places. Mm-hmm. And they trained us to be a Marine, and with the Marine feeling, and just to be so proud of what mm-hmm. we were. And they were very strict with us, mm-hmm. very, very strict with how we looked. We didn't have any time off, not really.
Uh-huh.
We were on duty almost 7 days a week,
wow.
learning at boot camp. It was quite strict.
Pretty intense.
Very intense.
And how many women, do you all live in one barracks? Or?
Well, we had one big barracks. It had two floors, and there were two units on each floor. So it was a big building, and it had a recreation room, which had a pool table in it. Mm-hmm. And in the wintertime, it had some mutts from the base on it, too.
What, animal, dogs?
Dogs,
oh.
that we would rescue from the cold,
oh,
which wasn't allowed.
Oh.
But we didn't want them to starve and to freeze out in the cold
yeah.
when it was winter. But it was a rec room that if people came to visit, like another Marine or something, they would announce that that person was there on a loudspeaker.
Mm-hmm.
And we would go out to meet them from our rooms. But they taught us, basically, they also taught us that they had hurricanes down there, so that they taught us that we had to sleep with our trench coat hanging on our double bunk beds
mm-hmm.
and boots alongside of them, so that in case a hurricane came, we could get out quickly and get into a safe place.
Where was there a safe place?
Well, into someplace
like
alongside the road, you know,
oh,
whatever.
Wow. How was it adapting to military life, like the food and the sleeping arrangements? How was all that for you?
I didn't have any problems with it at all. I had an upper bunk. It was private.
Mm-hmm.
And I was agile. I could certainly get into it.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a very nice bunkie. She was from New England.
Uh-huh.
We got to be very good friends.
Mm.
And not a lot, but some of the people cried. They were homesick.
Mm.
I was never homesick.
Mm.
My home wasn't that far away. It was only in New York.
Mm-hmm. And your parents
besides
were still...
which, I had a lot of encouragement from my dad and my relatives.
Had he been in the service, your father?
My dad sent letters, and my mother, and we didn't get phone calls, but we did get mail.
Uh-huh.
And there's a lot, and care packages.
Oh. Had your father been in the military?
No, he had not. He had tried to enlist, but he was a married man with two children, and they wouldn't take him.
Oh, okay. Now,
my parents, by the way, were first-generation Americans.
Really? Nice.
So they were very, very patriotic to this country, because what their parents went through in Europe
mm-hmm.
was a horror.
Yeah.
So they loved America.
Nice. Where were their parents from?
My dad's parents were from Russia. My mother's were from Poland.
Mm-hmm.
And they came here as children.
Oh, wow.
Mom came. They brought her here when she was 10 months old at Ellis Island. And Dad was about 4 years old when
mm-hmm.
they brought him over. Two different families.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Now, after basic training, Camp Lejeune, then where did you go?
Then I went to Cherry Point. I was stationed at Cherry Point, North Carolina, for all of my service.
Oh, you were?
Yes.
Now, what was there? What did you do there?
They assigned me to inspect parts of an airplane engine.
Is that because you had worked with Sperry on things like that?
It probably was, and the fact that I had had some math and stuff in college.
Mm-hmm.
I went into college when I was 16.
Oh, why so young? You're smart.
If that's maybe. I did skip a lot of classes.
You did?
Yes. And so I, 16, I went into Hunter College, and I took some math and French, and because I had taken Regents in French and Spanish. And so I stayed in college But there was a war starting around me, and I wanted to be part of that. I wanted to help my country. I said, I can't be a schoolgirl. I want to help. I want to do more. So when I left college, which was very hard on my parents.
I was going to ask you if they were upset about it.
They were very upset, particularly because it was free. You had to have certain grades to get in, and it was not co-ed in those days. It was all women at Hunter College.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Yes. So they were upset. But then I got my job at Sperry's in Brooklyn, a long trip. And they taught me to use a lot of measuring instruments. And because I was little and they had a mock-up of a turret. A turret that I was working on a gun sight that goes into one of the turrets on the B-27s.
A turret is a
hole? Upper and lower attached to the airplane, the big bomber plane that they used in England mostly. And they were doing, Sperry was doing the gun sight at that point for them, assembling it. And I was inspecting those assembled gun sights because I knew math and I knew how to use measuring instruments like a micrometer or something like that. So all of a sudden, when I got to be 19 or whatever, I was head of that department.
Wow.
Yes. It was so silly. Everyone was older than I. And because I was small, they put me into one of the mock-ups of the turret so I could see exactly what it was that I was working on, which was very interesting and gave me a real feeling of the danger of the person that was going to be in that. It was a very vulnerable position that that person was in, on a B-27, I think it was, that they used overseas in England, not the Marine Corps. That was an Army plane.
I see.
Yes.
And how long did you do that at Sperry?
I did that for about a year and a half, a little more, until I actually got to be almost 20, which was the age that I could get into.
Okay.
So I left, and then they told me that I was frozen in a defense industry, and I had to be unfrozen in order to enlist in the Marine Corps. I said, so what do I do? They said, get a job for 6 months and you'll be unfrozen.
But you had a job.
Yes, but I had left it thinking I could get into the Marines.
So what did you do then?
I wasn't quite 20. I was only about 18 and a half or something, 19 I was going to get in. So I went and got a job doing typing and a little bookkeeping, which I had learned at night while I was going to high school with the WPA. From World War II, during World War II, President Roosevelt had made these very good things for people. And so it didn't cost me anything. I went to school dazed, and at night I was taking typing and stuff like that. So I got a little job in an office. And when I got to be almost 20, I told them I'm going to have to leave. And they were very sorry. They liked me, and I liked them. And they were paying me $10 a week. That was good money. Wow, I could save a couple of dollars from that.
No kidding.
Sure.
Did you live at home?
I lived at home always, of course. Yes. So I got that little job until I got to be absolutely 20 and had the papers at home just for my sign and my parents to sign. And I quit my job and they wished me luck. And I went home and I said to my parents, "Hey, Mom, hey, Dad, so I'm going into the Marine Corps." Mom was a little hesitant. "Oh, no." I said, "Mom, I'm not going overseas. I'm going to the Marine Corps in the United States." And my dad said, "Let her go." She's going to go anyway. So I went down with my papers to Manhattan, where the recruiting office was at that time. And I came in and I said, "Here I am." So then I had to have a medical exam. And they said, "You should be 5'3". So I said, "Oh, I'm 5'3". I wasn't 5'3". I was 5'2½". So when the doctor, very nice doctor, examined me, I took a very deep breath and I stood up so straight. And so that I made it.
Oh, that's funny.
He said, "Okay, you're enlisted.
That's great.
We will call you." That was in April
of
1944.
44.
And I went home very elated. I was so happy. I was going to help my country. I love America. Mm-hmm. I still love America. Mm-hmm. And I've traveled extensively all over half the world. Mm-hmm. And I love America.
Nice.
When I see that lady in the harbor when we fly back, I say, oh, it's so good to be home. So anyhow, they called me finally in May. I was enlisted, mm-hmm. but they called me in May. So I got on a train in New York, in Manhattan, was loaded with people going, it was loaded from service people.
Yeah.
And we took along a little something, you know, to wear. So we sat on them in the aisles.
Yeah.
Couldn't get seats, it was very crowded.
Oh.
Finally went down to North Carolina, and we were taken to Camp Lejeune.
Okay.
For our boot training.
And then you left for Cherry.
And after that, I was assigned to Cherry Point. I had asked for a different place, but they assigned you where they needed you.
Mm. What did you ask for?
I asked for California because I had relatives there. My grandparents were there and so forth. So mm-hmm. I wanted to go to California.
Mm-hmm.
But I was okay. It was what I had to do.
Yeah.
So I went to Camp Lejeune for boot training. And that was okay.
And then Cherry, what was it called?
And then after that, I was assigned to Cherry Point. After I had asked to be assigned to California, they assigned me where they needed me.
Cherry Point was in North Carolina,
which was
too?
Cherry Point, North Carolina. It was not that far from Camp Lejeune. Mm-hmm. Maybe, I don't know how the mileage, maybe 50 miles, mm-hmm. I don't know. It was still in North Carolina.
Okay.
And they assigned me to inspect an aircraft engine part, because that's what I had been doing
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
My job, and I knew how to do that. But unfortunately, I broke out in boils. I was allergic to cosmoline, which is what it was a preservative which was covering every part of that little engine. But before that, they had given me like a trade school lessons on what it was,
mm-hmm.
what it did, how it worked. It was like almost like an automobile engine
mm-hmm.
to me.
Now, what you worked on in Sperry didn't have that chemical on it.
Sperry. No, it was all taken apart, and it was on a stand, and it didn't have the cosmoline on it.
I see. Okay.
It was all in parts because they had to show us the parts, what was inside of it and so forth, and how it worked,
mm-hmm.
like an auto engine.
But then at Cherry... Yep.
That was at Cherry Point.
Cherry Point.
They called it a trade school. It was in a Quonset hut.
Oh.
And I liked it. It was interesting, very interesting, because I had never worked on airplane engines or auto engines before.
Mm-hmm.
And so then they assigned me to go to work after a certain amount of time. And they escorted me to the building, which was like a factory where everybody, most all men, was sitting around and doing that work. And I was greeted by a Marine, a young man, who came over to me and he shook my hand. This was very touching to me. He said, "Thank you very much for enlisting. I didn't join the Marine Corps to do this. And now you will be doing my job, and I can do what I wanted to do when I joined the Corps." And I never knew his name or whether he came home, but it was very touching. It
wow.
almost brought tears to my eyes.
What did he mean? He wanted to be sent abroad?
He wanted to go fight.
Fight, I see.
And that is what... that's what he was going to do.
Wow.
Because I took his job.
Wow.
And he was a lovely young man, and he shook my hand. I'll never forget that.
Sure, sure.
I was so proud.
Yes.
That I could help him
mm-hmm.
to do what he joined the Marine Corps for.
Mm-hmm.
I
nice.
Did too.
Yes.
But I knew I wasn't going to go overseas.
Mm-hmm.
So I sat down at a desk, and they showed me what to do. It was very similar to what I had been doing. And I worked at it for a while, and all of a sudden I broke out in horrible boils on my neck and face. it seemed that I was extremely allergic to the cosmoline, which coated the parts of this engine. And so they didn't have anything at the base to treat me with. We didn't have a whole medical facility. We had a sick bay. Mm-hmm. If you were sick, you went there. And there were people, nurses, I guess. I believe they were Navy persons that did that on our base. Mm-hmm. So they had to send me to Camp Lejeune, back where I had my boot camp, because they had a hospital there. Ah. So when they put me to the hospital, they examined me. And they had no medication in that year, in the 1944 about. They didn't know how they could possibly help me except with x-ray treatments. So it was a rather bad experience for me, because I can remember it very clearly. I was put on a gurney, and they were all the other side, very huge room. And the other side of the room had all machines of little green lights in them, and they were x-ray therapy type machines. Mm-hmm. So they radiated me. Mm. And this went on for several weeks. Each time they sent me by bus over to the hospital and right back home to Cherry Point afterwards, and I went right back to work. It didn't make me sick.
Oh.
Did not make me sick. I never got sick from this, but I was a mess, mm-hmm. full of boils.
So it was one day a week you had to go?
It was one day a week for,
okay.
I don't know how many weeks, but a lot of rads. Too uh-huh. many rads, unfortunately, which caused me a lot of problems later on.
Mm-hmm.
So I was able to, they thought they had it stopped.
Did you notice an improvement in the boils?
It stopped. I stopped getting the boils, yes, and they expected that. That was the outcome. There was no medication for it in those days. There was nothing. And I accepted that, and I didn't know what the results would be. I had no idea. I just wanted to get back to work and do my job.
Mm-hmm.
So I did. Back to work. And they changed my job to transportation so that I would not have to work indoors or near that type of allergen or whatever it was that could hurt me.
Did anybody else develop that?
No.
Oh.
So I don't think that there were any other women doing it. It was mostly men.
Oh, and they didn't?
I didn't see any women down there.
Mm-hmm.
So They said that they were going to teach me to drive a truck. So I said, well, that's nice. So they had civilian men on the base. It wasn't a draft yet. My dog is in the way here.
Yes.
Joe.
It's a stretch.
Joe, please move. Please move. Stay there. Sorry.
That's okay.
So anyhow, they sent me out with a civilian on a small flatbed truck to learn to drive a truck. They did not know that I knew how to drive a car.
Oh.
I never mentioned it because I never drove a truck, and I figured it would be very different.
Sure.
I didn't know. They sent me out with this man, and I didn't care to work for a civilian, to work with a civilian, and he wasn't very nice.
No.
He was not very nice, and I don't prefer to go into the details.
Okay.
The only detail I will tell you, that because it's funny, it drove like a car. He was driving.
Oh.
And he was driving, but while he was driving, I did not care for his conversation or actions towards me. He
okay.
was a civilian, uh-huh. lived nearby.
I wonder why they had a civilian training.
They had a lot of civilians working on the base. They were not in service as yet. They may have been 4F.
Oh.
They may have not been qualified to work.
Mm-hmm.
He was from one of the neighboring towns.
I see.
So I was not happy with this person, with what his language to me or his actions towards me mm-hmm. as a young girl.
Mm-hmm.
And I took a hold of he was driving. I took a hold of the wheel, and I twisted it.
Oh.
And I put the car in a ditch.
Oh, my God.
No, not a very small ditch. And I got out of the car. And I walked back to the garage. It was quite a distance, but I walked back to the garage, and I told the people at the garage, I said, we had a slight mishap. Please go and rescue your truck.
Mm-hmm.
It's in a little disc, and it's in a dish. I told them where it was, and they went. So they said, well, how do you feel about driving now? I had only been out once on a truck. I said, oh, I feel fine. Mm-hmm. It seems to drive like a car. I feel okay. So they said, okay, you can take a test for a military license now.
Mm. Okay.
So I said, it's fine. So they gave me a military license. It was myself and about 14 men, young men, mm-hmm. 14 or 15, and I said, well,
was it a written test or a...
test was on the base, uh-huh. a driving test. Ah. It was very, 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 very hard. It had stop signs where you wouldn't think there would be signs, arrows all over the place. And they put a box next to me on the seat of this small truck, and the box had jars in it. The jars had to be upright when you brought the truck back. Mm-hmm. In other words, you weren't allowed to stop short or anything uh-huh. like that because they would break.
Right.
So I did the test, and it was very hard, but it was interesting too. I had never driven that type of a vehicle before, although I did drive a car, but mm-hmm. not as a licensed driver. You know, just like that in the Bronx, mm-hmm. in New York, a lot of us did.
Oh.
So anyway, it wasn't my car. So I drove it, and I passed. I don't know if some of the fellas didn't pass, but I did, because when I went to take the test, they were kidding me. They said, look who's taking a truck driving test. Look at the little blonde gonna take.
There were no other women, probably. No.
I think there was one other one, but I didn't know her. But I was the only one. So they were making fun of me. But that was all right. I passed. I don't know if they did. And so then I got my military license, which they told me was good in some other state, not New York. I said, that's fine. Oh. I don't care. I'm not going to that state anyway to live. Pennsylvania, I think it was, or something like that. So then I was assigned to drive. Mm-hmm. And I drove everything that was needed daily. Hmm. If it was a scooter, which was, it had a clutch, it was almost like a car, but it was a
wow.
scooter.
Wow.
And it took gasoline. Mm-hmm. I drive a scooter now, which was given to me by the VA, but it's electric mm-hmm. now. And I drive a car, of course. So I drove the scooter, and I drove several different types of trucks. I was driving a 3/4-ton Dodge truck, and I drove a Ford, half-ton Ford, all open flatback. And I drove a great big truck, very big, big truck, all over the base, which was enormous bases.
Wow.
I don't know what the acreage was at the truck. They had everything on that base that a person could need or want.
It was like a little town, probably.
It was like a big town.
Big town. Now,
it
what
was
did
an
you
air base.
It was an air base.
So they had many hangars, and they were learning. There were young lieutenants from the Navy learning to fly on that base. Mm. And they had bombers. We had B-25 bombers, and we had other planes. I've been in some of them.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yes. And yes, and
now what were you driving the scooter, say, for? Deliveries?
The scooter was only for mail. If there was mail or little packages,
I see.
It had a thing in the front, a big basket in the front attached to it, like a Good Humor used to have.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And you could stick packages in there, and I would deliver them.
Mm-hmm. I see.
Or I sometimes had an off base run if a. An officer was moving off the base from BOQ, Barry, you know, BOQ. His family was coming out to visit in a town nearby and to live there. Sometimes they moved.
Oh.
I would have to move his furniture. Oh. I never had to carry it. They always loaded a truck for me.
I see.
And I would take it off base by myself mm-hmm. into Morehead City or one of the towns near the base.
Mm-hmm.
I loved that.
Why?
Because when I got off the base, and I had a little time before I had to get back, I would find a little cafe, mm-hmm. and I'd get something good to eat instead of rations.
Oh. How was the rations on base?
Terrible.
Terrible.
I lived on peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for a long time, but I didn't never lost weight. I was healthy, very healthy. And then finally, they did build a cafeteria for the for the people that worked on the base, mm-hmm. for the civilians. But we raised a ruckus about that, so they let the people that were stationed there use it. And it was very cheap. Uh-huh. So 50 cents you could get a meal.
Why did you have to pay? You were part of the service.
Well, the food that we got was horrible.
Oh,
We had rations, except on holidays, or when somebody came to visit from Quantico or something. Then we had a decent meal. And every Sunday they had cold cuts. Uh-huh. And during the week we had rations because they were sending rations back. They were they had rations too much on some of the islands or bases or wherever.
And abroad, you mean?
Yeah. Uh-huh. So they sent them back to our base.
Oh.
And they were piled up against the back of the mess hall. And they tried to make food out of it, but it was not really very, very edible. I wouldn't give it to my dog at this point.
Really? Oh,
no.
Wow.
So they had peanut butter and jelly. They had hard-boiled eggs, which you had to open, make sure there was no little chickens in them.
Oh, my God.
You'd take about 5 eggs on your plate and open them to make sure you could get 2 out of them.
Oh, wow.
But they couldn't help it.
Yeah.
The food was going where it should go, overseas.
Uh-huh.
Anything decent, you know, I had no anger about that.
Yeah.
I understood it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But when I got a chance to do an off-base run, I ate.
Good for you, yeah.
And also sometimes a crowd of us would get together. And some of the boys had what they called club. They belonged to some kind of food clubs and restaurants in towns nearby. And they would serve nice food. So we'd get together and we'd pitch in money. I mean, we didn't go as boyfriend, girlfriend like mm-hmm. that. When it was crowd.
A crowd
like
of friends, yeah.
6 of us or
nice.
Something. And we'd go into town, we'd take the bus off the base and get to the base with a pass. You couldn't get off the base without a pass. It was very secure,
mm-hmm.
very secure, mm-hmm. really was. And because it was an air base.
Oh, I see.
So there was a lot of security.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd go into one of these restaurants and we'd eat until we almost died. We'd eat so much. And they didn't serve liquor. It was a dry state. But they served, if you brought a setup, they would serve you wine or something.
Oh, okay.
You'd bring your own, in other words.
I see. You got paid as a enlisted person, so you had money to pay meal.
Yes, we had, I got $50 a month as a private,
uh-huh.
and as a private first class, I got $54 a month.
Uh-huh.
As a corporal, I think I got $66 a month.
Oh, okay.
So we paid, we paid for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd have a decent meal once every few months or so.
I see.
We didn't have much furlough, as they call furlough in the Army. We call it liberty. We didn't have much liberty.
Oh.
There was a war going on. They needed what we were transporting around the base.
Really? So didn't get much time?
They needed the transportation very badly.
Huh.
And when I drove Colonel Noon, I was the proudest Marine in the world.
Now, who was Colonel Newman?
Colonel Noon was the chief of our base. He was the commander of our base.
Ah.
And when he needed to go someplace, he would haul for me.
Oh.
And they would bring his Ford station wagon out with the flags on each fender.
Mm-hmm.
So as we drove through the base, the car was being saluted.
Yes.
And I felt like the biggest big shot in the world.
You were driving it.
Of course. I was his chauffeur. When he had to go someplace on the base, which was quite often, he would ask for me.
Nice.
And he was kind of a grandfatherly type to me.
Mm-hmm.
He was probably much younger than I am today. But to me, he was, you know. And he used to sit in the front seat with me and mm-hmm. talk to me about his family and things.
Nice.
Very nice man.
Very nice.
He was our commander, the CO of the base.
I see.
Colonel Noon. I'll never forget him.
Colonel Noon.
Noon. N-O-O-N.
Okay.
He was a lovely man.
Nice.
And when he got out of the car, I would wait for him to take him back. And he got out of the car, there would be naval people at the doors of the building, standing guard. And I was supposed to get out of the car and open the car door for him, but I didn't know that. So I sat in the car. And the guys had to come over and open the door and salute the colonel and escort him into the building. And then they argued with me. They said, "Why didn't you get out?" I said, I'm just a girl. I'm not opening a good door for a man.
That's great.
I wouldn't do that. And I never did.
Was the colonel, did he notice? Was he upset about it?
He didn't care.
Okay.
He was so nice.
Yeah.
Well, I rescued his dog.
How'd that happen?
That's another story. I had a lot of stories. If I was a writer, I could write some funny books.
You should.
Every Marine Corps base has a mascot.
Oh.
It's always a bulldog.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Bulldog. A regular bulldog. I guess his name was Pal. I'm not sure. He was taught to march. When we had exhibitions, when people came to visit, they would have a marching. We had grandstands, and we were allowed to sit in the grandstands and watch the marches. Mm-hmm. And Pal would march alongside of them.
Oh.
And he was a sergeant. He had stripes.
Really?
He had a blue and gold uniform.
Wow.
Well, anyway, Pal got in trouble one day, and Colonel and a brother called me. They said, you always liked to talk about dogs. You like dogs. Please go up and see what you can do. He seems to be sick.
Oh.
So I went. I took the Jeep, and I went to way out in the boondocks where the colonel lived in a beautiful little house. Beautiful. Not so little. Bigger than the one I have now. And there was Pal in a circle with about 6 big naval people around him in a circle, and Pal was crazy, barking and growling, and they couldn't get at him. It seems that he had tangled with a terrible other little animal.
Oh.
And he smelled to high heaven, and he was crazy. So I said, what am I going to do? I have the Jeep, and I got out of the Jeep, and I went towards him, and I said, I'm going to talk to him like I talk to my own dogs and see what he had. Because they were trying to get him, and he tried to bite them.
Oh.
And they were afraid. They were in a circle around him. So I started walking towards him, and I said, what's the matter, baby? Just like I would. What's the matter? You sick? What did you kill? You smell something bad. And this dog came trotting towards me. And he jumped right into the Jeep in the front seat.
Now, why was he at the colonel's house?
He tangled with a skunk.
Oh, God.
So he smelled very bad. So he got into the Jeep. So the naval personnel, they were in full blue, you know, they were lovely, all dressed up. They were the guards. They said, good, we're leaving. I said, no, you're not. I said, two of you get in the back of this Jeep because I'm not going to be in this dog by myself. He might attack me. They didn't want to, but they did.
Mm-hmm.
Two of them got into the Jeep with me. And I drove him to Colonel Noon's house. The gate was open. He had gotten out of the gate.
Where did he usually stay? With the colonel?
With the colonel.
Oh.
He was the colonel's dog, really.
Oh, so he got out.
He was the base dog, but he was the colonel's dog. And he got out of the gate.
I see.
And he went and he killed a skunk.
Oh.
And he was horribly stinky.
Yeah.
So the fellas didn't want to go in the Jeep with me, but I insisted. I said, I'm not taking him unless I have some protection here in case he gets crazy.
Sure.
He didn't. He liked me.
Oh, wow.
So I took him back to the colonel, and I made sure that he got into the thing, and they closed the gate.
Yeah.
And then they left, and I drove back to the garage. And I went into the garage, and I said, clean this car up. And I walked back to the barracks and got into the shower.
Oh, God. That's a good story.
But I saved the dog.
Yeah.
He was fine.
They
took him to a vet, and he was fine. Joe said. So, anyhow, that was just one of the funny things
that
happened.
That's very funny,
and,
yeah.
You know, things do happen.
Now, did you establish friendships with other women on the base?
Well, I did have a very good friend. She lived in New Jersey, Thelma. Her name was Thelma Cohen. And she was in my barracks, and we got very close.
You knew her before you went?
No.
Oh, you met her there.
I met her there.
Okay.
And she was from Paterson, New Jersey. And she got a job as in the tower. She knew when planes were coming and going, and she had a job there. We had an airplane called the Lady Leatherneck. Mm-hmm. It went from Camp Lejeune to Cherry Point to Washington, D.C., and back again. Mm-hmm. It ferried people.
Ah.
If you were going on a Liberty or wanted to get a ride on the Lady Leatherneck, put in for it. You could get it. I flew it many times.
You did. You actually flew the plane, or you flew in it?
In it.
In it.
In it.
Okay.
No, no, I could never fly a plane.
Okay.
No, I drive a car or a truck, but I don't try to fly a plane. So I was a passenger quite a few times. It would stop at Cherry Point from, it went to it was at Camp Lejeune, come to Cherry Point, and go to Washington, D.C. So it would pick up people at Washington, D.C. if they needed a ride back to one of the bases.
Uh-huh.
So it was like a bus going back and forth, you know.
Nice.
So I flew it. And one of the best flights that I ever had was a USO show came to the base, and it was Joe Louis and his whole entourage.
Nice.
And
nice.
He came, and they put on a boxing match on our base.
Oh, you're kidding.
And then they were going back to New York, and I got a furlough.
Oh.
I got a weekend furlough. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'm going on that plane with Joe Louis.
Oh, wow.
And all his people. And they partied all night. We didn't know, you know, we were sleeping. So the next day, when they were leaving, I was right there, ready to go. I said, I'm going. And I met Joe Louis, and I met his trainers, and he had a whole bunch of people
sure.
with him. And they carried on the plane. When we got off the plane in D.C., they had a limo waiting for them. They took us, me and my bunkie.
My
bunkie along.
Into the limo?
We got into his limousine, and they took us through Manhattan, and they stopped at various places in Manhattan. They got us bagels, and they got us things to eat, and they left us off at a subway so I could go up to my parents' house.
Oh, nice.
So my bunkie and I, Leota, her name was, Leota and I went to my parents' house. But before I left, Joe Louis was passing me by, and I shook hands with him. My hand disappeared in his mitt. And I said to him, good luck, Joe. I said, I like you so much. I said, take care of yourself. I wish you luck.
Nice.
And he said, thank you. And he smiled at me, and he signed a dollar bill for me, and I have it.
Really?
Yes.
Nice. Very nice.
And his whole bunch of people signed that, but I have it at home,
the dollar bill. That's
so
a
that
good
was
story.
Fun, you
yeah.
know?
So you kept in touch with your friend,
I couldn't keep in touch with Leota, my bunkie.
Leota.
She lived in New England.
Oh.
But I did keep in touch with Thelma Cohen, who was a friend. She lived in Patterson. Mm-hmm. And when her mom died, I went out there to send a funeral.
Was she in the service with you?
She was in the same time I was in. We were discharged at the same time. So I knew her, but I lost track of her. I don't know what happened to Thelma after a couple of years.
Mm-hmm. Now, how long were you there?
How long?
In North Carolina on the base there.
I was at Cherry Point for
Cherry Point.
Exactly 2 years.
Wow.
Till the Japanese War was over.
Is that where you were when
the war was over in 45, but they kept us till 46.
Oh, they did. Now, what did you do once the war was over there?
When the war was over, I went home and got married.
Well, you said they kept you there till 46, so
I went in 44.
Right.
I got out in 46.
So the war ended in 45.
Yes.
So what did you do
I think it was toward the end of 45 or something.
Oh.
Yes, they discharged us. They invited me to stay, because they only let 1,000 women stay in the Marine Corps after the war was over with Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And they invited me to stay, and I said, no, I have plans for myself, and I want to go home. I have a career that I'd like to pursue.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And I did not stay.
Okay.
I have regretted it many, many times.
Really?
Yes. I wish I had stayed in for 20 years.
Really?
I do. Although I loved my career.
Now, what did you do when you left the Marines? Then what?
Well, I came home, and within a month I was married to my Marine, to Danny.
Had you met him?
I met him at the Marine Corps.
Okay.
He had come back from fighting the Japanese in the South Pacific, and they did not deploy them in those days.
Uh-huh.
And they sent him to my base, and we met on the base, and it just so happened that he came from the same neighborhood that I did in the Bronx.
Oh, wow.
And was of my own religion,
mm-hmm.
which was very unusual. Mm-hmm. There were so many different people.
Yeah.
And so we bonded, and when I got home, he had already established himself with my family because we lived near each other and didn't know each other.
That's funny. Wow.
And he knew where I lived, so he went and introduced himself to my family, and they wrote me letters telling me that this nice young man who said he was a friend of yours in the Marine Corps visited us. And the next letter said, well, Danny came over and had dinner with us, and so on and so forth. And that went on until I was discharged, which was a time later. And about a month after that, we got married.
So when did you get married?
We got married in the Bronx. We were married in a judge's chambers. And then after that, about a week after that, we had a religious ceremony.
What year was that? 46?
1946.
Uh-huh.
The same year I was discharged.
Okay. So what did you start doing once you were discharged?
When I was discharged, the first thing I started to do was to see how I could get back to my education. I didn't have any money. I had nothing, you know. Danny didn't have much either because his allotment had been spent by his family. He was in much longer than I.
Mm-hmm. Did he have a profession or what did he do?
I did not. He did not. He was a mechanic.
Ah.
Yeah. He worked on airplane engines and he was in service.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And overseas, mm-hmm. you know. But he fought also because he was a Marine.
Oh, I
when
see.
It was, when they were securing islands, the Navy brought them in.
Hmm.
But they had a fight on the islands. He
wow.
did. And he got a job working with airplanes and stuff, and that's why we ended up in Long Island, because airplanes were being made out here.
Mm-hmm.
And so we got married. I had my child a couple of years later, and we moved to Long Island
mm-hmm.
in 1965, 66, something like that.
That was a long time after you.
Yeah, yeah. We were in the Bronx for quite a while. We lived in the Bronx. We had a couple of apartments. And
what were you doing then at home?
Well, I was staying home when I had the child. Before that, I was working, trying to get money together so I could get back into college,
mm-hmm.
go back to college. And it just so happened I never could get enough money to go back to college. And so I took courses wherever I could find them,
mm-hmm.
cheap courses, $25 for 3 credits or something.
Mm-hmm.
I took enough credits so that I could then get into college eventually and get my bachelor's degree,
mm-hmm.
and then some years later my master's degree.
He
was working, usually doing aircraft work
and stuff.
And we moved to Long Island because there were aircraft factories out here.
Right. So what was your degree in from... Where did you go back to school?
I went back to school. I took courses all over the place, even from California. But I finally, to get my actual bachelor's degree, I went to St. Joseph's.
In what field was that?
I got it in, mostly nursing.
Nursing, oh.
Yes. I had all those courses. And so I got my bachelor's. And then I got into a couple jobs in hospitals. And then the one hospital, psychiatric hospital that I worked for, which was South Oaks in Amityville, they paid for my master's degree, which was a big help to us.
Yes.
It was very nice.
The master's was in nursing?
I kept working.
Oh.
And I raised my child, and my daughter was a librarian.
Oh, really? Wow.
She worked at North Babylon Library for 34 years.
Wow.
And
wait, but your master's was also nursing.
My master's was in community mental health.
Ah.
Because I didn't know which way I wanted to go, either to hospital or in the community. But it was mostly nursing courses.
I see.
Science courses, so forth. And yes.
Okay, so when you left, backtracking a little bit, when you left the service and you came home, how were you received by your family and friends?
Oh, they were just so thrilled to have me back.
Yeah.
They really were, and I was happy to be home.
You were.
I missed the service. It made a very big impression on me.
Really?
The training was wonderful. I was never abused in
mm-hmm.
service.
Mm-hmm.
I was thanked for my service.
Mm-hmm.
And I was invited to stay, which was very nice, flattering,
yes.
because they only let 1,000 women stay in the Marine Corps
mm-hmm.
when I got out.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to demur because I really wanted to go back and go home and finish up what I started.
How was it adjusting to civilian life?
I didn't have much of an adjustment. And everything that I had ever learned as a Marine, I was able to use.
Really?
In socialization, in friendships, not particularly with Marines, with people.
Mm-hmm. So and it really helped your life down the road.
It helped me to really mature, to really, really mature, and become part of a world, which I think is a very beautiful place to be.
That's good to hear. Have you remained in contact with any of your fellow Marines?
Well, I did with Thelma for a few years, and then I lost track of her, and I don't know what happened to her. And after her mother died, I think it affected her very badly. It affected me, too. I loved her mother. She was a lovely woman. Rose, her name was. Oh. I remember her well. But I lost track of her.
Now, where are you?
But I still had a Marine, my husband.
Yes. Were you a member of any military or veterans organizations?
Not at that time. Not at that time, no.
But now?
Well, now I belong to the Women's Marine Organization.
Nice.
Which I'm very proud of. And I didn't know it existed until I was invited to a lovely luncheon.
That's great. Good.
And that is where I met my Marine sisters.
Yeah, nice.
And
very
feel
nice.
Like I still have a big family.
Very nice. What do you think are some life lessons you learned from the military?
Well, the life lessons I learned were mostly, I think, people lessons. People. How really different and how very much the same people are, no matter what they are, where they came from, because we had people from all over at Cherry Point.
And everyone accepted everyone else.
Yes.
Yes.
And if you needed help in anything, said so. I had a sore tooth, and there was a naval dental person there, for some a DDS. I don't know why we didn't have any of their other medical. He pulled my tooth, but no problem. I went that evening. I was able to eat in the mess hall. So,
nice.
I mean, it was great.
Yeah.
And no, I was very felt very secure there.
Mm-hmm. So
and,
what?
And I felt like I was proud.
You were proud.
Proud to be doing what I was doing.
Nice.
Very proud. Yes.
How do you think your military service impacted your feelings about war or the military in general?
There's two different things.
Yes, that's two different
war
things.
War is war. Military is military. You do what you have to do. I think war is a horror. I would love to abolish all wars, but this is something I can't do. I'm sorry. But as far as military people, I respect them very much, very much. I understand what they have to go through. And I wish that I had stayed in and helped. I would have been one of those women that went overseas. As it is, I have traveled a great deal. Most women have never been to Croatia, for instance, or to Uzbekistan or Russia.
Wow.
When it was the Russia in the 80s. And I've been to many countries. I traveled with a nursing group.
Really?
Yes,
nice.
they have a club, and it's a travel club. And we traveled cheaply at night.
Just you yourself or your daughter too?
I went every summer practically. I traveled to Europe and Far East and
very nice.
Middle East and whatever. Not the Far East. I was supposed to go, but they canceled that one. But I've been to the Middle East, and I've been to Europe, and I've been to the UK many times. And I just love it.
Nice.
I was able to do that. When I was not disabled, I was able to go.
Yeah.
Now I don't do it, and I'm glad I did. I've been over the United States also.
Really? Wonderful.
I have relatives in California and so forth, so I've traveled the United States. And I've flown as many hours as some pilots, I guess, and never lost my fear of flying.
Good for you. What message would you like to leave for future generations who might view this video?
Future generations, I would say, just try to make this world beautiful. Love each other, no matter what. We may be of different faiths, we may be of different colors, but have a belief in something and just be kind. Be kind and generous. And love your neighbor.
Yeah.
And really be a good person. And I think that I learned that very, I didn't know other people. I only knew my family mm-hmm. and some neighbors when I was young.
Mm-hmm.
But meeting people from all over the world
mm-hmm.
has made me a better person.
Mm-hmm. Good.
I like me better now than when I was a crazy kid.
Well, we like you a lot. And thank you, Annabelle, for your service.
You're very welcome.
Thank you so much.
And I would like to add that I have no anger toward the government, toward the military, because of my disability.
Mm-hmm.
They did what they could and what they had.
Mm-hmm.
I have never had anger against them.
That's great. Well, thank you for serving. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.